like almost no one there. Yeah. Do it.
What's the situation with the different strains of the virus around the world? I keep hearing that there's, because we had a more virulent strain in UK, and now apparently that's spread to, I don't know how, to America and other places.
Viruses adapt.
No one's going anywhere.
Viruses adapt to their hosts, and they change, and they will change, and that one will change. And
sure.
You know, it's not a new one. It's just a, well, it's a variation, you know. The British one, the Brazilian one, I don't know, there's another one in South Africa, but all these are just adjusting to their host and to their immune systems. So that's what you'll see. I don't know what the implications will be for the vaccines after that, but anyway, you know, the vaccines, I was talking to a nurse who works in ICU today, and she was getting vaccinated, and we had a conversation, but I told her, you know, the vaccine is just so that you don't get the disease COVID and you won't end up on a machine or in a hospital, because it won't stop you from getting the infection and spreading it. And she knows it. She knows it, and everybody knows that. So that's where we are. It's a mess. In Ireland, we can't go 5 kilometers away from our homes. The schools are closed. Everything is closed. There's only food shops opened. You can't leave your county, you can't leave your town. Well, I'm in the countryside, so it doesn't apply really much here because we apply the cows and the sheep around us. But that's what the situation is. And it will be like that till the end of the month, and they're thinking of pushing it back into February. I think in France, there's a curfew at 6 o'clock in the evening. And if you're caught in curfew, you're fined on the spot. And
we've got a curfew here at 9.
Yeah, you have curfew in Greece too now, have you?
What's the point in that? I mean, most people are out in the day.
Socializing and drinking. Because once you socialize and drink, you lose, you know, control, and you start to walk and kiss. And then I think that's the big thing, to stop people from having parties and getting together.
It's a party ban is what it is. Yeah.
Right, I see.
It's also it's cruel. It's cruel.
But in terms of those mutations, it's like now we've had a year of the virus, and we've seen how we can work out its mutation rate, because it's how many people infected and how many mutations you've seen. I think they're like, you know, they're three variants, three major variants, and I think they're like 20, 21 mutations. So it gives you an idea of, you know, how many people are infected now. I lost count there, but it's how many millions they say globally.
I think it's nearly 100 million, but that's just the
So
that's 400 million.
Okay, so let's say it's 100 million. So let's say you've got three or four major variants or mutations or strains every 100 million. Okay, so to get herd immunity, if that's impossible, you get 80% of the population, so it's at least 7 billion. So basically, it means that we've got another 100 strains or more to go, if I'm doing the maths right in my head. It means we have 100 to 1,000 strains, isn't it? Something like that, more to face before it's run its course. So basically, they've got to reevaluate their strategy. It's not going to work.
Yeah, but the herd immunity is another story, because, I mean, in my country now at the moment, there's nearly 30% of the population who's been infected, tested. 30%. That's 160,000 people out of 5 million. Yeah, that's about that. I mean, am I wrong? I'm not very good at calculations. I can't follow what you're saying, you, very much. But, those people have been tested. There's about, among the 30% of people who have been, there's about now emerging about 5% who've got the British strain. There's a few little percentage showing the African one. So all this is just going, you know, exponentially. Everything is exponential at the moment anyway. If you look at all the calculations, everything is growing that way. There's no worldwide. I'm not talking about particular countries who are trying to kind of manage their numbers a little bit for obvious reasons and economical reasons. But
I mean, you can do a few back of the envelope calculations, and you can see we're a lot more screwed than they're letting on.
Okay.
I mean, this simplistic narrative that, you know, you wear masks and that's supposed to do something, and you have a vaccine and it'll soon be handled, and it's all one virus, and it's this very simple narrative it's not really facing how really screwed we are.
The mask is only protecting the people that you meet from you. That's all.
It's a thin aerosol, right? I mean,
yeah, it's because it's what you are spreading on other people that can be stopped by the mask, but it doesn't protect you. So don't think that when you're going out or you're going on a plane with a mask that you're not going to catch COVID, because it doesn't protect you. Okay.
Yeah, it spreads. Once it's an aerosol, you're pretty well screwed, because it spreads on surfaces. It stays on surfaces for 24 hours. So it's like, yeah, you know, the mask is just a placebo. It's just really shibboleth to make everybody feel more secure. And because otherwise the government says, fuck all we can do. It's not a good thing.
It has a certain percentage of efficiency for transmission. But it doesn't, it's not, of course, it's not the solution. The solution, we've talked about it before. We're living in a global city, and people are traveling all over the world. We're depending on everything, on transport to bring kiwis from New Zealand to bloody Connemara, and we know, and bananas all around the world. And once we, that's the problem.
But the problem is, everybody has all these lessons to learn from COVID. And if I say on Reddit, you know, basically the lesson to learn from COVID is this civilization is not viable. And like, fuck, you get downvoted to hell. They say, like, that's what the virus is saying. It's saying we cannot have this density of populations, this kind of food chains. And they're not telling us what the Chinese are saying. Is basically, it's in the fucking food system. It's coming to you, shrink wrapped. And they're all like, no, don't, that's a conspiracy theory. It's not a conspiracy theory. The Chinese have done tests. You can find papers that say at two degrees, 14 days. It easily gets from why the Tyson Foods were given immunity, because otherwise they were going to have to pack up shop, because they knew they were spreading the virus in fucking packaged food. There's they ought to tell the truth and say, like, guys, we've got to rethink how we live. And, and have the reset debate is, do you want to have it as, Schwab wants it, with a techno-utopia, and Bill Gates want it? So basically we all get chipped and hey, by the way, chip is for real. It's not a conspiracy theory. They do plan to chip you. And then basically let's have the debate. Let's have the... How do we restructure society, given that now we know that the idea that we just go onto the stars is bullshit? You know, I think no one wants to have that debate.
No. I think all here in UK, all people are focusing on is, hey, vaccine is fine. It's going to be okay. Vaccine.
I kind of wish, in a way, it was worse, because the thing is, people are just not getting the message. You feel like you should amp up the pain a bit somehow. But I mean, it's not this and it's over. It's just like Trump. It's not Trump and it's over. It's like the Nipah virus is waiting there. I mean, Sophie posted that thing, and basically the Nipah virus is one of those real serious ones, like Marburg's and all those horror ones. And it basically has 70% mortality and like spreads like a ninja. So basically, all these things are waiting in the wings, and everybody's like, no, we'll just deal one thing at a time. It's like, no, let's stop and look at this in toto. I haven't heard this conversation once.
The vaccine, to come back to what you said, is just for the health systems in Europe anyway, and I don't know, in the States probably, that are completely overwhelmed for about 15 or 20 years anyway. And now it's to save that, because That's all. There's a vaccine. That's why the vaccine has been developed. It's not to it has to be said, but it's not said. People are just thinking, oh, in March or in June, we're going to go back to normal because everybody will be vaccinated. You know, it's just like, it's just
to keep out of
the whole health system in Europe everywhere. And there's no more beds, no more nurses, no more doctors. And
it's just to keep you out of hospital band-aid, mm-hmm. right? The vaccine is just to keep you out of hospital band-aid. They're just hoping against hope that it'll stop transmission, but nobody's got much faith in that. And so basically it's just stopping the healthcare facilities not being overwhelmed. But I got a feeling like this is not, intuitively, this doesn't sound like a good idea to me. Because for one thing, have we forgotten about, you know, basically antibiotics and creating superbugs? And you say, like, surely what you're doing with this is breeding the variants that spread the quickest, and basically eventually you'll wind up with a superbug that spreads super quickly, and the vaccine does nothing for, you know, as soon as the thing hits you, you'll be in hospital. So although viruses normally they tend to become more benign over time, that's because they kill off their host in this kind of Darwinian elimination contest. But if you have the vaccine, you're masking that natural, the natural defense that basically it's kind of like, to use an analogy of fire, so you say there's this raging forest fire, and then everybody thinks that the vaccine's a fire break. It's not. You're just dampening down the fire, but now you've got this zombie fire that just creeps more and more of a bigger area. Isn't that the correct analogy?
Yeah, but it's not exactly that, too. It's for vaccines and for viruses, because you can't really compare that with the antibiotics and the selection of superbugs. Because what's happening is that, like, it's like for the flu vaccine that started about 15, 20 years ago, where they started to intensely vaccinate people for the flu, because it was changing every year. It was getting more and more active, and it was weighing more and more on the doctor's workload, on the hospitals, and the death toll. So what they started to do is every year they added in the vaccine for the flu a new strain that was from the year before, and took one out from about 12 years before. So every year, the batch of flu vaccine that you get is for about 12 strains, including the last one. And the year after, you'll have a new one. So I think that's what's going to happen with the COVID. It's going to be just become part of a program of vaccination that is going to be just spread worldwide, like a band-aid to cover up our stupid way of living. But I don't see it exactly the same way as the antibiotics, because they don't work the same way, because viruses are proteins, bacteria have got membranes, and they don't reproduce the same way. They don't live in the host the same way. But you know, we need them anyway. We have so many in us.
But talking again about intermediaries, I think it's a very bad idea socially for having normalizing vaccinations as a routine. So if you have 6 monthly vaccinations, sure, you can say, oh, well, don't be a conspiracy theorist and stuff. You say, like, how long is it before these companies start realizing, well, once they can give you a dose of serum every 6 months, how long is it going to be before they're going to try experiment with what they can actually put in those dose? It's basically, it becomes like, you know, a food pill or something. And they say, you know, it's so Orwellian, it's dreadful. But they, you know, out of this one fear against this one virus, then people will normalize the fact that you have a serum injected, say, 3 months or 6 months. And it's saying, like, in this world of nanotechnology, when they're talking about the great resets and all these fantastic things that they want to do in genetic engineering, and you're saying you're not worried at this, basically, the barrier that's being removed in terms of the social thing. It's and it's all conspiracy theorists. It's like, no. This is more than this is a change to us as humans, that you have global injections every 6 months is a change to our species. That's a new species you're talking about.
Somebody was saying, I was listening to UK Column on Friday, I think it was, and they were saying, I mean, this is, because this is RNA, I mean, this is like gene therapy, isn't it? It's almost like this is the trial. Like, we're just going straight to trial on the whole population.
Yeah, but they used it. They steamrolled it because they suddenly saw a gap.
Yeah.
Because they knew that genetic therapies would never get in the next 40 years. So basically, it's easy to be conspiratorial because it was such a boon for them. It's basically in 11 months, they squeezed through the door in a panic what they would never get through the door in 40 years.
But you see, so
it was a dramatic extent for big pharma.
It was easy. The world was prepared for that. I mean, I've seen in the last 25 years, I don't know if it's the same in the States, but in Europe, opening all sorts of little offices called travel advisory bureau. With the developing of tourism, young people and people in general have been cruising and going around the world on planes and boats to different tropical places on a crazy scale. So those big businesses have grown where you go before you travel and you get a list. Like they tell you where you go and they look. And I've know a friend who works in those things. So it's algorithm. Let's say you're going to the Philippines. So there you get. You've got this in the Philippines. So you have to get that. And we'll add on a tetanus and we'll add on the flu. And people get this kind of jabs. And then they go again 6 months later to South Africa. They get another one and they take their malaria tablets. So the terrain is prepared for this kind of crazy dystopian way of living, where instead of adjusting to your environment, you're getting tablets and jabs in order to do the unthinkable.
Again, in terms of just social inequality, is if you have a COVID passport, I mean, you honestly think that it's going to stop at a COVID passport? If you have a COVID passport, that'll be with you for life. You'll have two passports. It's one for you, or this biometric, and then one for this whole host of shit that you have no idea what will go into a health passport. But if you start down the game of health passports, you have no idea. Just think through what it means in terms of population control, movement control. How basically, if you're in Honduras and you're basically escaping a humanitarian disaster, because your health passport, there's no way as some refugee get a computerized health document. And so it's so bad, and everybody's just like rushing into it because of COVID, and we're not allowed to discuss it. And you say, like, and you know, and if that's not bad enough, cherry on the top, you're not allowed to be conspiratorial either. It's like, fucking take to the
I
was about to say that shit reminds me of that. Have you guys seen that movie Gattaca?
Got a lot of clips from Gattaca.
That's where that health passport shit leads. Fucking, not only do you have a class society of rich and poor, but then all whose genetic, it's literally like fucking like 21st century Nazism right there.
Yeah, but I mean, we're talking about things like designer therapies, designer genes, designer babies. So you will have independent companies that have this patented technology that fucking you grow a longer penis or two heads or, you know, super intelligence or memory 10 times the average Joe. And basically it'll cost you $100K. And then basically you'll show somebody and say like, hey, you know, look at me. I've got a sports car and I've got this 100K gene therapy, which basically, you know, won some of me. It's like, you know what that world is like? It's like, guys, rebel. You don't want to live in this world.
Yeah.
Well, maybe that's enough for that today. I guess I'm feeling crazy about this, but I've got to let everybody go eventually.
I think I have a good suggestion of how the left and the right can talk. And the conversation can start with what freedom is and what living a good life is, And I'm sure if you sit down and go through all the details, you'll find that civilization is giving us neither of those things.
Well, that's a difficult one, but maybe we should schedule this one for the next conversation, because it is giving a lot of people stuff. So, for example, it's giving people a lot of people that have into identity politics and have a fringe identity. They think it's giving them a lot. If you think of people that are disabled, then they think they're getting a lot out of this. So then they think it's very ableist talk if you say stuff about freedom and stuff, and they say, like, my freedom relies on a wheelchair and a healthcare system, and your idea of freedom is death for me.
Oh, so you're right. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's a very, very difficult conversation. So a lot of people are into identity politics because in the short term, basically they've bought the population with the short-term idea that we'll look after your identity. Well, we all fucked that way. Everybody's identity included, but they buy us off each one, just like you know, just like a prisoner's dilemma. They break up the mafia by getting people to turn against it, and so we are humanity, which is their big mafia, the opposition mafia, and they buy us off one by one, saying, okay, we'll splinter them, saying, what's your special need, what's your special ego, what's your special identity. And then they buy you off with a pittance to, again, from Shakespeare, Macbeth. They betray us they buy us with small sympathies to betray us in deepest consequence, I think is the quote. They win us with trifles to betray us in deepest consequence. I think that's the quote from Macbeth. And that's probably a good place to stop.
Yeah, so maybe talking about freedom and a good life next time then, or
what is freedom, and how do you sell people who are caged chimps? How do you sell freedom to a caged chimp?
Yeah,
that was born and brought up in domestication. What a subject.
Yeah, holy shit.
Yeah, that's a good subject. Very timely.
I think we're going back to the beginning of the desideratus conversations there. We're kind of eating our tails. We're going back to the same know yourself. And the,
I have been working on the desiderata, and I will have them done and put them up on the website. It's just I've been kind of, I can't concentrate on that because of this shit coming down the pipe so fast this week and next week probably.
Thanks a lot. That video was brilliant. It made me look at all the other ones of Darwin again, because they all tie together, and it's really a gigantic work. It's gigantic work.
Yeah, what I'm really trying to say in that is, guys, Darwin's theory was just capitalist bullshit that they were just using to divide us and get us to compete with each other. So basically, when we compete, banks win. And that's what Darwinism was all about. They sold this stupid mind worm that, oh, that's how nature works. So you can't fight it. It's natural. We're fucking you up the ass. But it's nature's way. Don't fight it.
It's funny. Darwin substituted the banks for the environment. Like, holy shit.
Yeah, it's like nature works like a bank. Don't try go off into the wild or you'll get fucked up the ass, just like we're doing to you. It's like, I think you're pulling a little porky here. I'll be a hell of a lot better jumping away from tigers than I will outrunning bankers.
there's no science without ideology, and that's a big thing to take out of that. Like, there's always an ideology in a lot of breakthroughs of science that you can't separate the two. And there's no science.
I'm saying Darwinism is a religion. It's the same old trick where they've sold us this, you know, and then they all think they're all rationalists and they don't have religions and stuff. And I say, Darwinism is your religion. It's got as much proof as Jesus and God. You're just bullshitting yourself, just like you got high priests and Darwin is your patron saint. It's a fucking religion. Dickie Dawkins himself was basically heading for the choir, and Dickie Dawkins would have been a priest. It's just he found a new religion in Darwinism, and then he could be a scientist. And he didn't have to do that. But Darwin himself was destined to be a priest. He was on the track to be a priest. And he said, I've got one better. I'll create my own religion.
Oh, Darwin's man. A cult leader.
Mm. All right. Well, we went further than we probably should have, but all right. Better cut it off. Thanks for all your patience, everybody.
The weekend's not over, so stay safe and thanks to everyone.
Yeah. Just keep information flowing to XRMed if you see anything.
All right, sounds good. Take care.